All right, so my presentation is going to deal with electricity. So who produces how much electricity? Should we produce more? Should we produce less? How to produce electricity? All these sorts of questions. So, okay. This graph here shows the world distribution of electricity consumption per capita. What does this mean? So every country in this graph is represented by a bar. Every country is represented by a bar. The height of the bar is the electricity consumption per person in that country. And the width of the bar is the population of that country, represented in percentage of the whole world population. So the whole axis here is 100% of the world population. You can see the big countries like China, India, US. So for example, if we take China and the US, if we compare them, we can see that in China, every person on average consumes less electricity than the US, where in the US they consume a lot of electricity. But China has a much bigger population, as you can see by the width of the bar here compared to the US. So if you take the whole area of China, this represents the total electricity production. In China, the average person consumes less electricity per person than in the US, but the population is much wider. So the whole area here, that represents the total production of electricity in the country, the whole country. The area you can see is high. Yeah, so all the countries that have high standards of living, they're on this side of the graph. They have high bar, so high electricity consumption per person. Like us in Canada here, we have pretty high electricity consumption. Some of these are higher, it's just imagine. Their bar is too fit the name on them. That is not an incidence. There is a very strong correlation between standard of living and electricity consumption. So here in the graph we have the Human Development Index, which is some type estimate to quantify quality of life against the annual electricity consumption per person. So as you can see, the countries that consume very little electricity, their quality of life is very low. And then the more developed countries consume more electricity, their quality of life is very high. And there is, all the countries follow this trend. There is no way to get out of this. So if we go back to this graph, when we see the distribution of electricity consumption of the world, what should be really, really shocking is that the vast majority of the world consumes very, very little electricity. At least 80% of the people, their electricity consumption is very, very low. And with this low electricity consumption, it's impossible for them to have a decent quality of life. So what should happen is that all these bars should rise tremendously. So if we want them to rise, for example, to 800 watts per person, which is it's not enough, it's still than what we consume in Canada, less half, but still not too bad. It's like around France or Japan. So if we want to do that, we have to fill all this air with new power plants. That means we have to more than double the current electricity production. That is a tremendous amount of electricity. If we want it in 30 years, for example, that means every three days we have to build a new big new reactor for 30 years nonstop. This is a lot of electricity. And another thing that should be very clear is that there is no shortcut. There is no way to get out of this. It's absolutely necessary. If those countries rise out of poverty, they have to tremendously increase their electricity consumption. All right, so now, how do we produce electricity? Now that we know that we need a lot of it, let's look at how we can produce it. So the traditional ways of producing electricity are by burning something. So they're here on the left. So burning coal, oil, or gas. Mostly coal. Coal is the most widely used method to produce electricity. Hydro is also used a lot, like especially in Quebec. There's a little of wind and solar, and there's also nuclear energy. So which one should we choose to, if we wanna power the world and develop? Yes, compare all of them. So if one source of electricity that will power the world for many decades or centuries to come and produce a lot of electricity, double or triple the actual production, we need to set certain criteria for electricity production. So it has to be clean. It has to be very abundant. Like we have to have enough supplies for a lot of use. It has to be reliable. It has to be a proven technology. This one is important. It has to be a technology that at least few countries have used, and they rely mainly on technology and whether it works. And this is important because it takes a lot of time to go from something in a lab, an idea in a lab, to implement something large scale. And especially if we want to implement that in developing countries. So it has to be a technology because we don't have time to try some out. So it takes a lot of time from both from thing that a little idea in a lab to something implement something large scale. Especially if we want to implement that in developing countries, we have to go with something that works already. And it has to be deployable anywhere. So any country should be able to use that type of energy. All right, start comparing. So coal and oil, a little bit similar there. So not very, especially coal. There is a lot, but they're not abundant enough so that we could rely mainly on them for centuries. Let's especially at the type of production rates that we want to reach eventually. Otherwise, they're reliable. It's a proven technology. They can be deployed anywhere. Gas is also similar to those of fossil fuel, but it's much cleaner. So we could consider this to be a clean. Wind and solar. So those ones, they're clean and they're very abundant in the sense that they're not going to run out of sun and wind. But unfortunately, they're not very reliable. The wind doesn't blow all the time, and it's not always sunny, and there is no sun during the night. So it's not proven because there is no country that rely mainly on sun and wind, and there's country that has developed using relying on this type of energy, and it cannot be deployed anywhere. There has to be that amount of wind and sun. We have hydro is pretty good. It's clean, it's abundant, so there will always be water is viable. Proven technology, like in Quebec, we produce almost 100% of electricity from hydro. But unfortunately, it cannot be deployed anywhere. So you have to be lucky enough to have the river, the waters to be able to build it. And finally, as you probably guessed, we have nuclear energy. So nuclear, it fits really, really all the criteria. It says it's clean, it's very abundant. We will never run out of uranium. There's a lot of it. It's very, very reliable. It's a clean technology. So if you take on tech, for example, we produce here 60% of our electricity from nuclear. France, for example, uses 75% of electricity from nuclear. So definitely a clean technology. And it can be deployed anywhere, just like the fossil fuels. All right, so we need nuclear power. Now you might be curious to know what is the current status of nuclear power around the world. So here we have a map that shows the number of reactors in a country. So the red circles, they show the operational reactors in different countries. So you see the US has a lot of reactors. France, Canada has quite a few. Germany used to have stuff. So data is from 2009, which is a little bit old. That was before Fukushima. So at that time Germany still had a reactor. Japan, South Korea, yeah. And the gray circles, they represent the operational plus the reactors under construction, or the planned reactors. So you can see first that in the West, there are not a lot of new projects in nuclear power. The current reactors are mostly in the West, but the new projects are mostly in other countries, in China and in the other parts of Asia. So what, when a country that does not have nuclear power and they want to start building nuclear power, they usually buy it from another country. And there are just a few countries that export nuclear reactors. And these countries are Russia, China, South Korea, France, and the US. Canada used to, but we're not doing anything right now. So this is another map. This one shows the reactor exports. So it only shows reactors that are built by a country in another country. The color of the dots represent the country that is building the reactor. So you see that most of the dots are orange, and that is Russia. Russia is the main exporter of nuclear reactors around the world. And there are countries building reactors like China is building in Pakistan and Argentina, among others. South Korea is building a reactor in the UAE. France and the US are building reactors in China. China is interesting because they have their own reactor, their own design reactor that they're exporting. And they're also building their own reactor at home. It's just not shown on this graph. But also importing reactors from everywhere. So they're building an American reactor, a French reactor, Russian's reactors. In the past, China also built imported reactors from Canada. One thing that you notice is Canada is not in list here and there. And this is very sad because Canada used to be a pioneer in nuclear engineering. And then we actually exported reactors in China and South Korean parts in Europe, but we're not doing it anymore. And part of the reason is because CANDU reactors are not very, very relevant anymore, and there probably will not be CANDU reactors in the future. But that doesn't mean that we cannot work in that field. Canada still has had or still has expertise in nuclear. We could use that to develop this industry in other countries. That would be very good for our own, I mean, for the economy of the country receiving nuclear reactor. Anyway, so now I want to change the topic a little bit, and I want to talk about nuclear waste, because this is one of the main criticisms for nuclear energy. So, before talking about waste, let me explain what is nuclear waste. So we have here the fuel cycle of CANDU reactor, and which is very similar to the other types of reactor. So we have we mine uranium from the ground. From this uranium, we produce our fuel. So this is what we call a fuel bundle, So the fuel is inside by the metallic tubes. The tubes are filled with uranium oxide, which is the fuel. And we put these ones in the reactor. And then there are hundreds of these fuel bottles inside one reactor. So they're inside the reactor, they use a lot of heat. And after a little while, like months or years, we take them out. And when we take them out, they become waste. The whole thing is what we call waste. But in fact, if we look at the uranium that was used, we only less than 5% of the uranium was converted into energy. The rest of the uranium is still there. Just that it would be complicated to use it, to process and use it. And because uranium is so cheap, it's easier just take this whole thing and throw it and new fuel, new uranium. So when we say throw it, we don't literally throw it. We are planning, it hasn't started yet. We are planning to put it in what we call a deep geological repository. So what we're going to do, we're going to take the fuel bundle as it is. We don't cut it or make powder or anything. We just take the whole thing. Many of them, put them in a big container that is made of special material that will not rust or in underground. We put this container inside a cement block, and we put these blocks in tunnels underground. And we surround them by a special way that will absorb water in case there's any water passing by. The site of the repository has been carefully chosen to be not in a seismic area, to not have any history of earthquakes or anything like that. So this is the plan. Right now, I think they're still selecting the sites. They're like examining the ground on different places, different communities in Ontario that are willing to receive the repository. And I think they will start the use fuel inside in 2050. So you have to understand that we don't accumulate these things very quickly because the energy is so dense. It's very, very easy to just put a few of them like on site in the nuclear power plant and just wait a few decades. So that's what they're doing. And this solution would work. Like there's no real problem with this solution. The only problem is that people are still not comfortable with the idea of having this underground being reactive for thousands of years. Even if we make sure where we engineer it in a way that will not be dangerous, they're still not comfortable with it. The good news is that we can actually get rid of the waste. So there is a way to produce nuclear power without producing waste, or almost no waste. This is done with the reactors. So this is a different type of reactors, similar to the ones, but a little different. They're a little bit more complicated to build, but they exist, and some of them are operational right now. So what they do is that they take, so the uranium that is being consumed inside the reactor, at the same time as the uranium is being consumed, some of the uranium is being transformed into something that is usable by a normal reactor. So what we need to do is just to have these type of reactors combined. What happened? I'm sorry. Combined with a reprocessing facility. And also, we can combine them with normal reactors. It's not necessary, but it's cheap. And only input into this whole cycle would be a natural uranium. And then inside the reprocessing cycle, we're going to take care of taking what's coming out the breeder reactor, and then what's coming out of the normal reactor, separate all of these things and remix them in a way to make fresh fuel for the breeder reactor, and then fresh fuel for the normal reactor. And by using this cycle, it's possible to extract 100% or nearly 100% of the energy contained in uranium. So we would have very little waste. The only waste that we would have are the fission products. So when the uranium fissions, it splits into something else, and that something else is called fission products. This would be the only waste, although waste is not a good word, because a lot of these isotopes that are created, these fission products, many of them are very valuable for like space or medical applications. And also, they're not radioactive for thousands of years, like the normal waste. And anything that is not very that is a little bit tricky to deal with, can just put it back in the reactor, and sooner or later it's going to be transformed into something else. That's going to be easier to deal with. And the other thing that is really, really amazing is that we can actually feed this cycle with current nuclear waste. We don't even need to mine new uranium. We can take all the waste that we've been producing for years and use it as fuel for the future nuclear power. So this type of energy is really a good candidate to power the future, essentially. All right, so I just want to put the thing together here. We have our current distribution of electricity consumption with the orange bars. And as we can see, there is not enough consumption of electricity in most of the world, which basically means that they're underdeveloped. And to develop them, they're going to have to increase dramatically their electricity production. Obviously, not all going to be done with nuclear power, because nuclear power takes some time to develop. So initially, they will use a lot of coal, oil, and gas. That's okay. And that's what we did here in developed countries to develop initially. We should use hydropower as much as we can. But as I said, it's not possible to do it everywhere. So for the longer term, and to really keep increasing the electric production, we will have no choice but to rely on nuclear power. And this is not going to be, all these things are not going to be done by themselves. We have to make sure that they can, and that's why we're here, I guess. So yeah, that was all I wanted to present. And thank you.